Hey everyone! The response we received from Dr. Crifasi's interview was overwhelmingly positive. So today we have part two. She'll be discussing important topics such as rumors we've heard about popular medications, to ventilators, to what we can expect in the future. So Dr. Crifasi, thanks for coming back and speaking with us again.
Thank you for having me back.
In the news, we've heard some concerning statistics about ventilators, particularly that they don't have enough of them. So what are the implications of that?
So what happens with the coronavirus is if you start to have a severe reaction, depending on multiple factors, then at one point you might actually need a tube down your throat in order to assist with your breathing. Now, one of the things that isn't as spoken about in the news is that if you get to that point, you don't have a very good prognosis or a very good likelihood that you're going to do well if you get to the point of needing a tube down your throat. And unfortunately, because this tube down your throat can prolong death, depending on what your situation is, then a lot of these people end up passing away, but it takes a week or 2 weeks before they pass away. And so there might have been somebody who was in a healthier condition who could have probably needed a ventilator for a couple of days or perhaps survived if they had one, where somebody who wasn't very healthy and who probably wasn't going to do well either way ended up using a ventilator for a couple of weeks before it was available for someone else. And so that's why there's a concern about the shortage, because if someone does need it, it can really prolong the situation for a bit of time. And it's a valid concern, and it's really going to be city dependent in terms of who is most at risk.
Okay, now I thought of something while you were speaking, particularly because I volunteer at hospice, and a lot of care is palliative. It's to ease the comfort when someone's in the final stages of their life. So can it be argued that a ventilator might help with pain or breathing, even though it doesn't improve their condition, or not so much?
So a ventilator is not part of end-of-life care. It's not part of palliative care. What we do typically before that is we give people supplemental oxygen. So we have lots of ways to help people with their breathing, giving them a breathing treatment or giving them some extra oxygen. And so if you get to the point where you have an entire tube down your throat in order to facilitate your breathing, we're really not at an ideal place for you. And when it comes to people who we think are going to pass away, typically, sedating somebody if, say, they didn't want a tube down their throat, which is the case for some people, they don't want extreme measures, then to keep them comfortable, we can give them pain medication and we can help sedate them so that they can have a peaceful, relaxing state.
I see. Okay. Well, that's comforting to know. So is there anything people shouldn't be doing or any particular medications we should watch out for that don't interact too well with the virus?
Well, one of the things that is an unfortunate consequence of the media trying to educate people is that I think it's important for people to be aware of a virus that's there and that they should seek medical advice under different conditions versus telling people about medications that they don't quite have the wherewithal to completely understand. And so what happened with this is that anytime anything was mentioned, people would call their doctor to try to get a supply, even though they weren't sick, which from an ethical standpoint, from either end, from a physician prescribing it or from the patient, doesn't sit well. And besides that, these aren't benign or simple medication. So some of the medicines like chloroquine, you can actually die. And we've shown that in different studies for people who took high doses of it, that they had a heart disease issue and they died sooner and they had to quit the study. And so it's not a simple drug to be taken at home. The only people who should be taking anything like that are people who are hospitalized, where every single day they can be observed to make sure they don't develop heart abnormalities and end up with consequences from something they thought might have been okay, which just isn't the case in this condition.
So in particular, I actually heard something trying to caution us from taking ibuprofen. Is there any accuracy to that?
So The background is that ibuprofen, in the studies that we've seen so far, has been shown, if it's taken for 8 weeks, at least the ones that I've seen, if it's taken for long enough, can eventually increase what's called the ACE2 receptor, which is on different cells in the body, and some of those being in the respiratory system. Now, the coronavirus happens to use the ACE2 receptor in order to gain entry into a cell. And so the question that was occurring was whether or not, if you take ibuprofen, that this was going to increase your susceptibility to the coronavirus or lead you to have a more severe infection. However, given that these other participants in an unrelated study, by the way, when they took this ibuprofen and showed the increased ACE levels, they took it for 8 weeks, right? And so that's a couple of months of taking ibuprofen at a high dose, which doesn't necessarily compare to taking it for a few days at the recommended dosage. And in addition to that, even if after a couple of days you're taking some ibuprofen, we don't have evidence that it's going to suddenly increase ACE2 receptors, and then also, if you do increase ACE2 receptors, that it's going to make you have a more severe coronavirus infection or more of the infection than you normally would. And part of that is because the way that we decide how you're going to do with the coronavirus tends to do with your baseline health and not because of all these other small factors. And so the World Health Organization currently does not recommend to avoid ibuprofen because of what I've just mentioned here. And really, in terms of health or concerns, the people who should maybe be cautious with it in general would be people who have diabetes and high blood pressure, because those two conditions can worsen any sort of issues that you're having on your kidneys, and in themselves, they can weaken your kidneys, and ibuprofen is filtered through the kidneys. And so if you have diabetes or high blood pressure, you probably shouldn't take ibuprofen much anyway. And so that would be a baseline recommendation, but healthy people should be fine with it.
So here's the $1 million question, so to speak. What can people expect in the future in terms of a vaccine or a possible resurgence of the virus?
Well, that's definitely what is on most of our minds in terms of what's going to be coming next. And as far as that goes, we really have to have data to look at what happened in the past and then what's going to be able to be predicted for our future coming months. And these things do take time. And so when it comes to a vaccine, we have to inject it in people and then actually expose those people to the coronavirus to see if a vaccine works before we go and we give it to the whole population and then hope that it works, right? Yeah. And so these are things that are really stepwise processes before we can ensure that we spend all of this money on a vaccine, wanting to make sure that it's actually effective for people and that it wasn't just a complete waste of time. And so far it seems that having a vaccine within a year would be ambitious, and we're going to have to continue to monitor as much as we can how the progress is going. And what we've seen from other coronaviruses in the past has been some level of a resurgence once people are taken off of quarantine or once they don't have as much social distancing. And so I think that should probably be expected as opposed to it being a thing that continues to recur. We don't necessarily think that's going to happen like we do a seasonal flu, but I think that there should be an anticipation of some sort of resurgence in the coming months.
Now, say someone is otherwise healthy, but they're working in the healthcare industry, or they're working in a service industry where they're required to have repeated contact with various people, or something as simple as they forgot to wash their hands after touching multiple objects. What would the recommendation be, or the course of action for those people be?
Well, if they slipped up on some of their precautions, or they thought they were taking some precautions and they ended up getting the coronavirus anyway, typically what happens is people can either call their telemedicine doctor. There are a lot of different sites to use that is typically covered by insurance, and that's a great way to stay at home without exposing yourself to more people in an urgent care or in your doctor's office or in the hospital. And then you can ask about your symptoms and really see where you fall as far as that goes. And then the rest is going to depend on what kind of symptoms people have. And it really takes a trained doctor to know when somebody should be appropriate for testing based on those symptoms, or when they probably have a common cold. But otherwise, I would say that if people are concerned or they think they've had a cold for longer than they normally would, say, a week out, they're still having fevers, chills, and sweats, or anything they're concerned about in terms of their breathing, the best thing to do is call and get some professional medical advice, and then we can go from there and submit people for testing.
So thanks for coming back and speaking with us again, Dr. Crifasi.
Well, thank you for having me.
Thank you, everyone, for tuning in.